Good morning, Harvest. Good to see you guys. If by chance you don't know me, my name is John Nichols. I have the privilege of serving as the campus pastor here and the privilege of opening God's Word with you this morning. So you're going to need a Bible, as always, on a Sunday morning here. So go ahead and grab it or open your phone or your screen or whatever you're going to do. We're going to dive in and continue in 1 Peter. We're going to be in chapter 3 this morning. As you're turning there, I want to tell you a story about me and Amy. This is when our kids, now 24 and 22, they were probably 6 and 4 at the time. And Amy and I were sitting down after dinner one night. They were probably in bed. And she said, hey, listen, I a couple things I need to tell you about this weekend that you need to take care of with the kids. And I said, well, what are you talking about? She's like, well, I'm going away this weekend with my girlfriends. You've got the kids this weekend. Well, you didn't tell me you were going away this weekend. I've been telling you this for months. No, you didn't tell me you're going. You can't go away this weekend. Like, I've got, I got to preach on Sunday, so I definitely don't have time to watch our kids. And I can't run them around. I got all kinds of things to do. You can't go away this weekend. And I'm just kind of firing at her all the reasons why she can't go away and she should have told me this. And then a shoe comes flying at me from across the room. I'm not joking. A high-heeled shoe comes flying at me from, well, she doesn't wear high-heeled shoes, so I don't know where she got it from. Came flying at me from across the room, but if I hadn't ducked, it would have drilled me in the face, right? And I can tell that, and everybody's like, yeah, that definitely wasn't a good thing in a marriage to throw shoes at your husband. And it wasn't, but if I'm being truly honest and transparent, she had told me 2 months prior. She had told me many times leading up to this weekend. I was just having an incredibly selfish moment where I was overwhelmed and didn't want to have to try to care for the kids while getting ready for a sermon and all the other things I had to do this weekend, and I thought it was selfish of her to go away. So she had told me the whole time. It wasn't a good moment for both of us. Let's just be honest in that. And fortunately, as soon as that shoe hit the wall, we kind of looked at each other and laughed, and we've laughed about it ever since, right? And I share this story because right? Every marriage has their challenges. Marriage doesn't always go the way we intend. We don't always get it right. I don't always live out the way I'm supposed to as a husband, and Amy doesn't always get it right as a wife. That's how it sometimes unfortunately works. Why? Because we're fallen. We're sinful. And I'm sharing all this because we've been in 1 Peter in these last few weeks. We've been talking about Christian conduct. Peter's been challenging Christians, and this is how you should behave in the world, right? Our conduct flows from who we are as a child of God, not as how the world might treat us. And so we want to live out this conduct because it's a great witness to this crazy, messed up world around us. And now Peter is going to turn his attention from talking to Christians in general, and also previous to this kind of slaves and their owners, to say, hey, listen, now we're going to talk about the home. What does conduct look like between husbands and wives in a home? And I want us to remember something before we dive into this today, because we're going to move fast. The title of this series is Strangers in a Strange Land. It's titled that for a reason, because a lot of what Peter is instructing them to, and now us to, is not what the world would necessarily agree with or like. Living as a Christian in this world doesn't fit, because this world isn't Christian. This nation, this town, aren't Christians. And so even today, as we look at conduct in the home, much of the teaching from God's Word is not in line with what the world around us would say. And we need today, as husbands and wives, as men and women, as everybody who's listening, because even if you're not married, you know somebody who is. Or maybe you want to be someday. So all of us are going to benefit and grow from this. So let's all lean in and listen. But let's listen with ears to hear. Ears sensitive to the gospel and not filtering it through what the world tells us is right or wrong. Because some of these truths are going to be hard. They're going to be hard. But let me also say this, they're only hard if you're not doing it. If you're doing these things, they're not that hard, but they're hard when we're not, because we want to fight against it, because our flesh doesn't want to do it. But it's the right way, it's the best way, and it's a beautiful way when we get it right. All that being said, we're going to just jump right in today. We're going to look at a word to wives and a word to husbands. And you're just going to get 4 things to walk out of here with, to hopefully help us have stronger, healthier marriages, to hopefully help all of us help each other have stronger and healthier marriages. So let's dive in. First word to wives is this. There's 4 things. First one is this to wives. We each have a role to play. We each have a role to play. 1 Peter chapter 3, if you're there. Likewise, remember that, he said this a couple times. We're in this same passage, the same idea talking about conduct. And that's all he means by this. We're still talking about conduct, right? And so likewise, talking about conduct, let's get to wives. Be subject to your own husbands. Not to somebody else's, not to some other guy, but your own husbands. Happy Mother's Day. Some of you are like, I wish I came last week. Mother's Day was probably a nicer, sweeter message. He just told me to be subject. Can we just be honest about something right up front? This is talking about submission. We live in a world full of submission. The world would look at you and say, submission is a bad word. It's a bad word in marriage. It's a bad word in society. Nobody should ever use that word or expect anybody to submit to anyone anywhere, especially not in the home. But it's not a bad word. It's not a bad word at all. God has set up submission in our culture. Every one of us, by the way, can I break this news to you if you didn't realize it already? Every one of us lives by submission. We all live under submission to somebody, somewhere. And it's a really good thing. It doesn't always function properly because sometimes those in authority don't use it, but it's still a good thing when it functions. It's a great thing when it functions right. I mean, if you're a teenager, you got all kinds of submission. You got mom and dad, you got coaches, you got teachers, you probably have a boss, and oh, by the way, you have the government. Every one of us submits to the government. They don't get it right all the time, but we do. As we talked about the last 2 weeks, it's a great witness when we do it with tremendous conduct and character. So submission is not a bad thing. It's actually a really, really good thing. And in this case, wives are called to be subject to your own husbands. What does that really mean? It means to willingly submit to your husband's authority or leadership in the home. To willingly submit to your husband's authority or leadership. By the way, let me be clear, this in no way implies that wives are less than in any way. Guys, hear me. This doesn't make your wives less than you in any way at all, ever. It's a role that God has given you. It's a role that God has given her. Wives are not less important. Wives are not inferior in person or spirituality. Wives and husbands are completely equal in value, just unique in role. It's a role thing. Husbands have certain roles and responsibilities in the home. Wives have certain roles and responsibilities in the home, and they come together. Ephesians 5 paints this picture a little bit more. All right, here we are again. Wives, submit to your own husbands, what? As to the Lord. Important piece, right? You're not doing this because Pastor John told you to, or Peter told you to in his book. You're doing it because in the end, when you submit to your husband, just you're submitting to the Lord. If you want to be submitted to the Lord, this is one of the things that we do to submit to the Lord, is submit to the husbands. But here we see the roles. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should, again, submit in everything to their husbands. These are the roles that God has given us in husbands and wives. Husbands are called to be leaders, leaders who lay down their lives and who make sacrifices and lead spiritually, and wives who submit to this. But guys, this isn't, again, a rule of thumb that, oh, well, I'm in charge and I get to make all the decisions. No. We're going to see it a little later of the great gift that our wives are to us. And if you're not listening, if you're not taking her wisdom and advice into consideration as you lead, and remember that leadership is more about sacrifice and service, you're missing a huge point. But ultimately, God has given this authority to husbands. They don't always use it right. I don't always use it right. I have sought forgiveness from Amy regularly, unfortunately, because I blow it. I blow it all the time. And husbands don't always get it right. But it doesn't give us the right. That's the objection, right? Well, my husband doesn't get it right a lot, John. My husband's not perfect. Like, submitting to Jesus, that's one thing. He's perfect. I can do that. But submitting to my husband, he's not so perfect. And yet God called us to submit to the government just last chapter in Peter. The government's not close to perfect. God calls us to submit to those over us in authority in this life. None of them are perfect. Jesus himself, the Son of God, the only truly perfect one, submitted himself to his parents for 33 years. He came under their authority. They didn't get it right. They weren't perfect. As much as some want us to believe that Mary somehow was perfect, she wasn't. And he submitted to her. And oh, by the way, Jesus submitted himself to the same government that would crucify him. This isn't about perfection. This isn't about always getting it right. We don't. It's a call from God that as you submit to the Lord, we submit to our husbands, because that's the role the Lord has given us. That's the role the Lord has given you. We've given us each roles. And one other thing I want to show you, I always put the pen down, I forget. This is what's beautiful. I went to Ephesians 5 earlier, so this is also there. Is this mystery? And what he's talking about is this beautiful role between husbands and wives. When wives play their part well and husbands play their part well, it is beautiful. It's a mystery. Nobody can fully explain it, but it's a mystery that's profound, and I'm saying that it refers to what? To Christ and the church. When husbands and wives get it right, that's your greatest witness in your home. When husbands and wives get it right, and husbands lead well, and wives come under well, and do it well, it's your greatest witness you have in this world. It shows the world the relationship between Christ and his church. And it's beautiful. It's one of the most beautiful things this side of heaven when we step into our roles right. We each have a role to play. Second word to wives is this. It's witness without words. Still in 1 Peter. Well, we'll be in 1 Peter all day. But back to chapter 3, right? Wives, be subject to your own husbands so that even if some do not obey what? The word. So some of you have husbands who don't obey the word. What he's saying is some of them, your husband's not saved. Your husband does not know Christ. So if even if some do not obey the word, they don't know Christ, they may be what? One. Without, I love this, without a word by the conduct of their wives. When they see your respectful and pure conduct. When they what? When they see your respectful and pure conduct. Witness without word. Some of us, some of you are married to men who don't know the Lord yet. And he's saying, listen, it's not about preaching at them. It's not about telling them every day why they need to come to know Jesus. He's saying, you want to win them to the Lord? Your best bet is to live in a manner worthy. To live in a manner worthy of your calling. To live in a manner that matches the conduct of your salvation. That they would see your conduct. They would see your character. They would see your love for Jesus. And that is going to be your greatest witness to your husband. Not preaching at him and telling him all the time why he needs Jesus. And telling him every day, I'm praying for your salvation, honey, because you need the Lord. But seeing your respectful and pure conduct. That respectful and pure conduct, it's not a picture of quiet submission. I'm just never going to say anything and I'm going to just be nice. It's actually, the word respectful there is pointing to the Lord. It's a respectful and pure conduct before the Lord. Your husband would see your reverence for God, your love for God, your obedience to God Most High. A life that honors the Lord, that's what it's pointing to. Character that is visible, love for Jesus that is visible, a transformed life that is visible and not hypocritical, not constantly nagging or pointing at all the things he does wrong. Remember, he's not a believer. So why are we expecting to act like a believer? He's not one. But let's demonstrate to him what it looks like. And he goes on in verse 3, or the next verse, he says, do not let your adorning be external. This word adorning, right, it's the idea of trying to make yourself more attractive, right? I'm going to primp myself up. I'm going to do things that make me more alluring and more enticing, right, to get him looking at me and attracted to me and maybe desire me. So he's saying, do not let your adorning be external, right? The braiding of your hair, the putting on of gold jewelry, the clothing you wear. But let your adorning, there it is again, be the hidden person of the heart. Don't let it be external. Peter's writing this to a culture where often the wife wasn't the only woman in a man's life. They often had maybe many, 2, 3, 4, 5 women on the side. And the wives would decorate themselves. They would adorn themselves and make themselves look as good as possible, hopefully better than anyone. Why? Because I want my husband to come home to me tonight. I want him to come home to me tonight. But again, think about it. It's all the wrong reasons. Why is he coming home to you? Well, he's simply attracted to your outer physical beauty. He's not attracted to you. He doesn't want to be with you. He wants to be with you in all the wrong ways. But that's what they would do. And he's saying, that's what the world does. That's not what we do. Is there anything wrong with braiding your hair and putting on makeup? No. Is there anything wrong with wearing a nice dress? No. But if your motivation, right, the hidden person of the heart, what's the motivation for why you do it? Is it to get him to look at me and pay attention to me? Then we're missing something. Peter is reinforcing this is a conduct and character and heart issue. You want to win him? Win him with who you are from the inside out. Let him see with his own eyes your conduct and your character and your love for Jesus and not simply be attracted to you because you look good on the outside. And what I love what it says the rest of this, right? With the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, what? Which in God's sight is what? Very precious. Saying, listen, this inner character is imperishable. It'll never go away. Physically, yeah, it's all going away. And it's going away faster than you can imagine. I'm gonna be 55 this summer. Like, I know, I've already had a spinal fusion. I can't move the way I used to move. I just saw a cardiologist for the first time in my life. Things don't work that well anymore. Things don't look that good anymore. I think it's so sad when I walk down the streets in our community or and go to the mall and you see women that are my age dressed like their 18-year-old daughter that they're with the clothes barely hanging on. Who are you trying to attract? And underneath all that, I'm sure, is a wonderful person. It's the inside that is so beautiful, and that's what's imperishable, and in God's sight is very precious. That's what God is looking for, and God wants for you more than anything else, is this inner adornment that will last forever. And when we chase this, we can truly witness without words. And this is what the Lord loves. The third word to wives is this: keep your eyes on Jesus. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Where am I going? So it says, for this, continuing verse 5, for this is how the holy women, simply referring to women in the Old Testament, historical Jewish women who have great character and conduct. We'll get specific in a moment, but that's all that means. The holy women are historical Jewish women of great character and conduct who hoped in God, key phrase I want you to remember, used to adorn themselves by submitting to their own husbands. Stop there. So they adorn themselves by submitting. This is how Jewish women would do it. They would submit to their husbands. They would do it from the inside out. They would witness without words. They would have the right character and the right conduct. But they did this because they hoped in God. They kept their eyes on the Lord. They kept their eyes on Yahweh. But we know the full revelation of Jesus, and so we keep our eyes on Jesus. Right? This picture of hoping in God, it's an ongoing thing. It's something that doesn't end. I never stop hoping in God. I never stop adorning myself on the inside and submitting. It's an ongoing thing. It's not always easy. I'm sure many of you, if I gave you the permission to raise your hands, would say, yeah, it's not always easy. My husband, oh, if you knew him. It's not always easy. I know how it's not easy because I know myself. No, it's not easy for Amy at times. But you keep your eyes on Jesus. He gets it, by the way. He gets it, by the way. Last chapter, we talked about this, talking about Jesus. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. We keep our eyes on the Lord, because he judges justly. For even those that if you had a husband who maybe never came to the Lord and was in jerk his entire time, he will stand before the Lord. We're going to hope and pray that he gets saved, but he will stand before the Lord someday. So we entrust ourselves to him who judges justly. It's not always easy. Jesus gets it. He suffered and died under bad leadership. He gets it. He understands it. But it's also the fact that who he is. He's Lord of Lords. He's King of Kings. He's God Most High. If anybody can change your husband, it's him. It's him. You know, Amy is really, really good at this. When we were early married, right? When you're early married, there's this excitement, but there's also like, hey, wait a minute. We suddenly live together, and there's all these things I didn't really notice that I don't really like. And unfortunately, we can be really good at pointing them out. You know, honey, that's really, you know, you got too many bottles in the shower. Like, you have 12 bottles. Why do you have 12 bottles in the shower? Oh, there's hair everywhere. What's going on? There's all these little things, but we can get so caught up in pointing them out, thinking this is what we do. This is how we figure it all out. We just constantly point out all the problems. But sometimes they get a little bit bigger. And on either side, we can become a nag. And there's been times when Amy, early in our mind, she'd just keep at it with some things. And my walls would go up, and I'd get more defensive. I wasn't acting the right way either, right? It was neither one of us were handling it well. And Amy has learned over the years, and she does this so well. And I don't know where she learned it or how, but at some point she said, you know, when I see something in John, I'm not going to point it out necessarily. Something he's got to work on. Maybe it's a behavior pattern. Maybe it's something he said that he shouldn't have said. It was the tone of his voice and the way he talked to me last night. I'm going to pray about it first. She keeps her eyes on the Lord, and she prays about it. And she will tell you every single time she has done it this way, the Lord has moved. Every single time. She's lost track of the number of times I've come up to her and said, hey, honey, I got to tell you what the Lord's doing in my life. I didn't even know I was doing this. But the Lord showed, like, I owe you an apology. Would you forgive me? I didn't know I was behaving this way. Would you? And she's got this little quirky grin on her face. McKee already told you this, didn't he? You've been praying for me, haven't you? Yep. Thank you. Thank you for praying for me. She keeps her eyes on Jesus, even when I'm a total jerk. Even when she's probably, in the world's eyes, justified to get in my face and call me out, she goes to prayer and keeps her eyes on Jesus. That's what we're talking about. Why? Because the Lord can change anyone. The Lord can change anything and do anything. And so we keep our eyes on Jesus. We keep our hope in him, and we go to him more than anything. Last word to wives, and then we're going to get into the husbands, is simply this. Treat him with respect. Treat him with respect. Where was I? Sorry. Continuing with the issue, remember, looking back to older women, Peter then singles out Sarah. And he says, as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, remember that. And we'll stop there, actually, for a second. Calling him Lord. What is this referring to? Most scholars think this refers to Genesis 18. So in Genesis 18, Abraham is hearing from the Lord that he's about to have a kid. His wife's about to get pregnant, and they're old. Like you'd say old and decrepit, and they're about to get pregnant. And Sarah is in the other, like if you can picture her with a cup to her ear and her ear against the door listening, like she's eavesdropping. She's totally eavesdropping in the moment. And it says this, Sarah laughed to herself, right? Again, to herself, she's alone, saying, after I'm worn out, I just love that phrase. I'm all worn out and old. And my Lord is old as well. Shall I have pleasure? This is a private moment, a quiet moment, nobody is there. They're in the other room. She's kind of caught off guard. She's laughing about it, right? You ever have that moment when maybe your spouse does something, you kind of want to laugh in their face about it because are you crazy? Are you nuts? That's never going to happen. What are you thinking? And she's having this moment. And instead of sitting there in her little room saying, man, I'm old. What is this moron thinking? What is this idiot thinking? You got to be kidding me. It says, after I'm worn out, and my Lord. Nobody's in the room, but she shows him great respect. To refer to your husband as Lord, lowercase l, was a way of showing great respect in that culture. Nobody's there. If there's ever a moment she can kind of just lay into the guy and make fun of him, but she doesn't. And that's why Sarah is held up as an example. That's why for women in Peter's day, to be called the daughter of Sarah was a great honor. Was a huge honor. Here's the thing. Did Abraham always deserve her respect? No. Does your husband always deserve your respect? No. Do I deserve Amy's respect? No. Not always worthy of it. I haven't always earned it. This isn't about whether or not they've earned it. This is about choosing to treat them with respect because this is how God has set things up. Right? Ultimately, again, placing yourself in the hands of him who judges justly. Look at Ephesians 5:33. Right, the end of that Ephesians passage I've referenced a couple times. This is how it ends. However, let each one of you, this is husbands, love his wife as himself. And let the wife see that she respects her husband. Why would the Lord, through Paul, make a distinction? Because most men don't doubt that their wives love them. Most men doubt that their wives respect them. That's why he made a difference. Most wives don't doubt that their husbands respect them. Most wives doubt their husband's love for them. This is why this is so important to respect. Respect, by the way, when you show respect, it's an indicator of your character, not the other person's. When you don't show respect for somebody, it's an indicator of your character, not the other person. Well, yeah, but they don't deserve it. They're a complete idiot, John. They don't deserve this kind of stuff. Why should I respect them? It just revealed your inner character, your lack of love, your lack of grace, your lack of mercy, your lack of submission to the Lord's instructions. To show respect is an indication of my character. I can choose to respect somebody even if they are incredibly mean and cruel to me in the moment. I can tell you when I think back over our marriage together and the times when Amy kind of came up to me and confronted me on something, maybe not always with the nicest tone, and the times that she simply chose to respect me and honor me and treat me with respect, this always got my attention. That never did. My flesh would rear itself up, and then I'd be an even bigger jerk. I didn't want to listen when I was being accused or there was no respect in the room, but the moment respect was there, I would listen a little more closely. And I begin to ask myself, maybe is there something I need to apologize for? Is there something I need to do? Is there something I need to change? We treat him with respect. The last little verse in this, by the way, says this, right? It says to Sarah, again, you are Sarah's children. Again, great honor for women. If you do good and do not fear anything that is frightening. Basically, another way of saying again, kind of a last drive home for the women. Listen, fear the Lord. Respect the Lord. Honor the Lord. And you're a daughter of Sarah. Live this way. Live out your role. And you're considered a daughter of Sarah, which was a great honor. There will be times, ladies, when your loyalty to God will supersede your loyalty to your husband. Said it, and I'll say it again. There will be those times when maybe he's trying to steer you away from the will of God or the glory of God. Yeah, then your relationship to God supersedes your relationship to your husband in that moment. There are times when maybe he's actually being abusive. Then your relationship to God supersedes your relationship to your husband. But if that's not the case, this is what we do. We show them respect. We can still be respectful even in those moments too. Think about that, right? When you're having to honor the Lord over the spouse, you can still be respectful in the way that you do it. I think that's plenty, ladies. Don't you agree? Guys, it's your turn. Word to husbands. First one is this. Be a lifelong learner. Be a lifelong learner. Okay? Likewise, again, continuing in the same issue of conduct, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way. Right? That doesn't just mean being a nice guy. Some of your translations might say considerate. All good things. Be considerate to your wives, yes. Be understanding, yes. Be a nice guy, yes. Be kind, yes. But it's more than that. Understanding is actually pointing to knowledge, like actual knowledge of something. So to live with your wives in an understanding way, it means I'm going to know and understand God's will for marriage, God's will for husbands, God's will for lives, God's will for our life together. It starts there and it's primarily there, but it would also include knowledge of your wife, what her passions are, what her likes are, what her dislikes are, what her strengths are. Again, that leadership thing isn't just you in charge of everything. It's like, hey, I got a great gift here in the Lord. She's pretty smart. She's got like great strengths, great abilities. We're going to do this together. But I need to know those things. And it's continuing to grow in your knowledge of those things. Throughout your lifetime together, studying passages on marriage, reading books on marriage, going to conferences, so that I'm always growing in my understanding of what this is supposed to look like. Because the day you say, I do, your flesh will try to fight you every day for the rest of your life. Satan will try to destroy your marriage every day for the rest of your life. Why? Because when your marriage is right, it reflects the gospel. He doesn't want that. And so Satan will come after your marriage every day for the rest of your life. So you have to be a lifelong learner, constantly studying, constantly getting to know them. And let me be clear on this, guys. This knowledge piece, you want to grow in understanding God's will for your wife, not yours. You want to know God's will for your wife, not your will for her. God's plans for her, not your plans for her. Now, your plans often will be the same because you're husband and wife. You want to know what her strengths and abilities and passions are. You don't want to superimpose your strengths and passions and abilities on her. It's not how it works. It's getting to know her. What would you think if I said I have a file on my wife? Like, I didn't call the CIA. But I got this idea from a friend of mine right after we got married. I keep a file on my wife. I was actually looking at it again this morning. I haven't looked at it in a few months. But you open it up, it's just important dates. It's the day we met. It's the day of our first date. It's the day of our engagement. Because I can forget those things. And I need to be reminded of them. So maybe I can surprise her and say, hey, and I think I did that a while back. Said, hey, it's been 25 years since the day we met. We're going out to dinner. It has a list of stores that my wife likes. And a list of her sizes. Guys, you struggle to buy gifts, I just gave you all the ideas in the world. Know her sizes, know what store she likes. Easy to shop for your wife. Should have done this 2 weeks ago before Mother's Day. It knows restaurants she likes, places she likes, favorite vacation spots, the things that she likes to do, the things that we like to do. This file gets edited over the years, and it grows, and it gets tweaked. She doesn't like that store anymore. She doesn't like that restaurant anymore. We're going to go to these instead. These are her new ones. It's got places from Arizona. It's got places from here, places we've lived. All kinds of information because I can forget things, but it helps me continue to learn. What is she passionate about? What gets her fired up? What does she love most about the Lord? What do I love most? I got one page is just a list of what do I love most about her? Because there are days I can forget and I need to be reminded of why I said I do 27 years ago. Be a lifelong learner, guys. Never stop learning about this great gift you've been given from the Lord. Second thing, husbands, is this. Treat her with honor, right? We continue. Live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel. And I know that last two words, everybody's like, hang on a second, especially the women. What do you mean I'm weaker? Every commentator I can discover, everything I've found in this says this simply is referring to strength, physical strength. Because again, we've already said, in no way are you less than. You're not less than. This is simply referring to strength. And if anything, it's referring again to the complement of husbands and wives, because you are different. You're unique in your role. You're different. So it's not putting women down in any way, shape, or form, and a man that would use that otherwise has totally lost sight of what God's word is talking about. But you're showing honor. The honor piece, this is the important part. Like I said, don't focus here, focus here. Honor has to do with showing great respect, of fulfilling a commitment that you've made. Let me ask you a question, guys. Did any of you say vows at your wedding? Till death do us part, something like that? It's funny, I love doing premarital counseling, and I love to do weddings with couples, and sometimes they'll say, hey, listen, pastor, is it okay if we write our own vows? Sure, as long as they're actual vows. I've had some young couples come to me in all their excitement, right? They want to share it with me. Hey, this is what I want to say to him on the wedding day. Billy, I love you. Billy, you're the greatest thing that's ever come into my life. Billy, I couldn't imagine my life without you. Billy, I'd be lost without you. Billy, you complete me. That's beautiful. You didn't commit anything to Billy, though. But vows are an actual commitment that you make, and I hope you made at your wedding. You made a commitment. And again, I'm not fulfilling this commitment out of duty, but out of delight, out of joy, because I get to do this for the rest of my life. And so I'm going to keep that commitment, and I'm going to show her great respect. Let me ask you a question. How do you treat or talk about your spouse in public? Both when they're there and when they're not. Early in our marriage, Amy and I were shocked at people. We'd be with somebody, and she'd be with some women, and one of the gals would just be ripping her husband up and down. I'd be with some guys, and this guy'd be ripping his wife up and down, and we're like, I don't ever want to be that person. And we made a commitment to not do that with each other, to make sure that the way we treat each other in private, in public, or in public without each other is always the same. It's with great respect and honor towards one another, and we do that to each other. Another way to think about it is this way. When we were first dating, so if you were here last week, I think it was last week, Pastor Jeff talked about how he drives. I don't know if you remember that, but I've been accused of doing the same thing. In fact, driving to Indiana for my daughter's graduation, I got a lecture for staring people down and, you know, weaving and following too closely and all that other stuff. So, I need help. I'll just fully admit it. But when we were first dating, Amy noticed I drove a little bit more aggressive than she did. And she leaned over to me on one of our first dates and she said, hey, I just want to remind you, you've got precious cargo now in the car with you. And for 27 years, that's been a joke. Like, hey, we got precious cargo, slow down. You got precious cargo, give this guy some space. You got precious cargo, relax. But think about the idea of, like, I think of precious cargo. I was thinking of a three-tiered wedding cake. Imagine you get in your car. You have a minivan or an SUV, so you put it in the back where there's lots of space. And you put that three-tiered wedding cake, and you've got to get it from where you got it to the venue that's 15 miles away. How long is it going to take you to drive that 15 miles? How slow are you going to accelerate? How far in advance are you going to start hitting the brakes when you see an intersection coming up? How slowly are you going to go around the corner when you're taking a turn? Because you want that cake to get there. You don't want to be the guy that ruined the cake. You're going to treat it with incredible respect and incredible gentleness because it's precious cargo. That's this picture of honoring, of treating your wife as precious cargo with great respect. Why? Because I made vows and I'm going to keep them because I want to and I get to. A great way to evaluate that, like I said, is to evaluate how do you talk about her when she's there, when she's not there, when you're alone, and when you're in public, and all those things. Look at this verse. Great reminder again. For me this morning and all of us, guys, he who finds a wife finds a good thing. And I'm going to say a really good thing. And obtains favor from the Lord. Your wife is an incredible gift to you. Incredible gift for you. Don't ever forget it. Two more to go. Word to husbands, remember her value. Continuing. Remember her value. Oh, read that. Here we go. Since they are heirs with you of the grace of life. Who's heirs? Right? Christ's. Your wife is a co-heir with you. You're not the only one who's an heir of Christ. You don't get some special position in eternity that she doesn't get. She knows the Lord. You know the Lord. She is a co-heir. She has tremendous value. Why? Because Christ put it on her. Through his death and resurrection, through saving your wife, Christ put great value on her. She is a child of the living God, and so are you. She has no more value than you, but she definitely has no less value than you. She has tremendous value. I would say she's the greatest gift you've been given this side of heaven apart from your salvation. That's the value your wife holds. In any way, I've said this before, I'll say it one more time, in any way that you ever think of her that is less than, you are so wrong, guys. So wrong. She has so much value. Ephesians 5, back to it one more time. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. Your wife is an extension of you. She's part of you. You became one legally when you got married. You've been spending a lifetime growing in that oneness. She is part of you. So when you treat her poorly, you treat yourself poorly. And in any way that you want to treat yourself greatly, you better think about treating her greatly too, because she's part of you. She's an extension of you. Let me ask you guys, if I were to open up your wallet, or your, let's pretend you still have checkbooks. We don't all. If I were to look at your checkbook, and I were to look at your calendar, would I be able to tell that you recognize the value of your wife? Because those two things are probably going to speak to it the most. Because if I value her as much as I value myself or more, which I should, then when I look at my calendar and I see that I'm playing golf 3 days a week, but there's no date for her, then I blew it. I see that I bought myself brand new golf clubs, or I'm going to get myself the new Harley or whatever it is, the new fishing stuff, and I haven't bought her a gift, then I blew it. In fact, to truly recognize her value is to say, hey, listen, I want a new set of clubs. I got to get that new rod. I need to get a new motor for my boat. But you know what? I'd rather take her away for a weekend. That's recognizing her value. My time, my money, it should be obvious to the world around me that I value her more than I value myself. And by the way, when I'm valuing her, I'm valuing myself. It's a win-win. Old saying, happy wife, happy life. It's a great saying. But happy because I value her and I honor her and I do all these things. Our wives are wise. Our wives are gifted. Our wives are talented, often in ways that we are not. Could we go back to that be subject to peace again for a second? Yeah, wives, I get that idea is hard. But husbands, when you do this piece right, when you recognize the value that your wife is wise and smart and gifted and talented, and you actually need her help, those two pieces come together, and it's the beauty of the gospel. And that's what we need to remember. Remember her value. The king gave you one of his daughters. Think on that for a second. Your wife is a daughter of the king. Treat her that way. Treat her that way. Last piece. Guys, pretty straightforward. Right? Since they're heirs with you of the grace of life, so that all this stuff we just talked about, your prayers may not be hindered. This is Peter's way of throwing in there. Again, the Lord is inspiring this. So this is from the Lord saying, hey, listen, you don't want to treat your wife this way? Don't expect me to answer your prayers. Period. Mic drop. Not going to answer your prayers. You're not going to treat her this way? I'm not. And you might say, well, that's just not fair. But parents, don't we do the same thing? It's parent discipline. We should do the same thing. You got two kids. Your two children are fighting in the home. They're treating each other with contempt and disrespect and being mean. And then they come up to you. Hey, Dad, listen, can I use the car? I want to go out with the buddies this weekend. No. You line up for your kids all the chores that they maybe need to do. I'm taking advantage of my kids being home for the summer and them being in the audience. When you're supposed to wash the dishes and mow the lawn and all those other things, remember those? But you line up chores for your kids. And what if you tell them all these things, the dishes and the lawn and the laundry and cleaning the bathrooms. You're going to help us paint. You're going to help us with the yard work. And your kids are like, mm-hmm, and then they do none of it. 2 weeks later, they've done none of it. They've skipped four different chores. And then they come up to you and say, Dad, listen, all the girls and I are going out tonight. Can I have $20 for dinner? And all the parents said, no. So why are we surprised as men when we treat our wives like this and our prayers are not answered? Why are we surprised? We shouldn't be. Not seeing a lot of prayers answered lately, guys? Maybe that's an indicator that we're not showing honor and all these other things. Husbands, ultimately lead by example. All of this. Lead by example. You've been put in a position, going back to how we started, you've been given a role, and in that role, you're supposed to lead by example. And so make sure you're doing that, folks. Make sure you're doing that, guys. And don't ignore the Lord. Last two things, I'm just simply going to say this. Two quick closing thoughts. It's been long. It's been a lot. I hope you've got a couple things you can work on. But closing thoughts is simply this, because one question I always get with this is this. What if they're not doing their part? John, this was great. I'm so excited to do my part, but my wife's not doing her part. What if she's, John, this was fantastic. I loved it. But my husband, whoo, he's doing none of that. I don't have to then, right? Wrong. Go back and study the text all you want. There's no outs here. Go look at Ephesians 5. There's no outs there. God doesn't give husbands and wives an out. Like I said, unless your spouse is leading you to sin, leading you against the glory and will of God, or there's an abuse situation, this is what we do as husbands and wives. Always. Even if they're not doing it. By the way, the best way to get them to start doing their part, go back to the inner adornment. Do your part and witness to them. Last one is this. Simply last piece of advice I'd give you is this. Don't do it alone. Don't do it alone. Marriage is, I believe the greatest gift apart from salvation that I've been given. Amy and I are hitting 27 years this summer. We never would have made it without our friends, without counseling. Not at all a shame to admit. I've gotten counseling because I've needed it. She's gotten counseling because she's needed it. Less than I have, of course. And we've gotten counseling because I needed it. But we have. We're not ashamed to admit that. We've gone to marriage conferences, not because I'm a pastor, because we need it. It's a great gift. And if you think you can do it without the community around you that the Lord has given you, expect to struggle big time. Expect it to be that much harder. This is an amazing gift we've been given to live this life together with. And we're meant to do it together. So don't do this alone. Husbands and wives, let's live out this beautiful role that we've been given so our marriages will show the world Jesus Christ. Amen? Let's pray. Father, you know this is my all-time favorite topic to teach on. You know I just absolutely love marriage. I think it's great. And I'm so thankful for my bride and the gift that she is. I'm thankful for the husbands and wives that get the privilege in this room and those that will in years to come. And I'm thankful that we have this community to help us. That's the beauty of all this, Lord. We get to help each other live this out. Lord, we want the world around us to see you in our marriages. Truly, we want that. And I pray you'd help us to want that from the depths of our soul, that the world would see you in our marriages. And so help us. God, I know that there are wives who've heard these words today and they're hard because maybe at home they have a husband who's not a believer. I know how hard that can be. God, I just pray for strength today. I'm going to pray for strength for wives and husbands, any of those. Maybe you're in a home where it's just not working well right now. Would you give them strength to persevere, strength to keep their eyes on you, strength to do their part and live out their role? Would you protect any that might need protection, Lord? If there is any dangerous situation, would you bring that to the light so we can surround our brother or sister and help them and protect them? And God, I pray for healing. I pray that the lessons learned here today would not just be heard and talked about for a day or two, but they'd be applied and that lives would change and marriages would change and that healing would come and forgiveness would come and repentance would come and transformation would come, God. I pray all this so that our marriages truly would be a witness to the world and that you would be glorified. You set this up. You designed this and it's beautiful. You gave us roles and they're beautiful. So help us. In every way that we need help today, if we need courage, if we need strength, if we need hope, if we need peace, if we need friendship to come around us, whatever we need today, God, bring it so that our marriages can get healthy and stronger.
and so that you would be glorified in all of it, Lord. Thank you, Father. In the great name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.